Welcome back to track two, day two of Plone Conference 2021. With me is Maurits van Rees, who is our Plone release manager, or one of our two Plone release managers. He's a very active member, a very important member of the Plone security team. And he is here today to talk to us about automatic focal points for images. Thank you, Maurits.
Thank you, Kim. Okay, let's start. So yeah, automatic focal points for images. That's what we're going to talk about. And it's going to be a tasty presentation because at Zest Software in the Netherlands, we have a customer who's creating stuff for bakers to use. And they also have all kinds of recipes on their website. And yeah, they have lots of images like this one with some kind of cake. And it usually looks a bit like this. You have some foreground, which looks nice, which is the thing they want to draw attention to. And the background, that's a bit blurry. And then, yeah, the baker, they can write some text over there and print it out as a poster, something like that. So when you use cropping on this, then, yeah, in standard Plone, it can look something like this, which, yeah, it has part of the a part of what you want to see and also a part of the blurry background, which is not so nice. But when we are done with this talk, we can improve that at least a bit to something like this, where Plone automatically detects like, hey, this part of the image, that's the most interesting part. Another example of that from the live site, although I think they don't have these recipes anymore actually. Before it looked like this, which at least the first two are, I have no idea what's inside there. That's very blurry. And afterwards it looks like this. So it went from blurry to yummy with focal points. So that's our goal for today. First, we have to talk about scales and modes and directions. And so, yeah, if we want to show a scale in Plone, yeah, you do that with a template. You call the edit images view on the context. And you call the, from there you use the tag method. You pass it image, which is the name of an image field, and some extra items. The extra items arguments, usually you say, give me a scale of preview or mini or large or a few others with a predefined width and height, or you specify your own width and height. And you give a direction, in this case, we call it direction scale. It's a bit double, we have scale preview and direction scale. So scale is used doubly here, which can be a bit confusing. And we have three directions or modes that you can use in Plone. Modes is more the more modern name, although I think in most cases, you still actually have to specify the direction instead. I think Peter Matthies is working on a pull request somewhere. This direction you can use scale, which is also known under the name keep or thumbnail. Thumbnail is a bit the old name, which is still used a lot in the core Plone code. The other names we've tried in recent years to, I think Mozilla has defined some things also in how you, if you would do this in CSS, some other terms are used, and we're more closer to that now. You've got scale, you've got cover or scale crop to fill, which is also used as up. And we've got contain, scale crop to fit or down. And let's see what's the difference between all these. So I've got our direction scale. That's the default actually, if you don't specify any direction, also called keep or thumbnail. And the documentation in, I think that was from plone.scale. It says this scales to the requested dimensions, so your width and height, without any cropping. This also means that the resulting image may have a different size than requested. And finally, it does not scale up. So we have our tag with an image field. We, in these examples, I'll use the same width and height. And here the direction scale. So we'll try it on the image on the left, which you saw earlier. And it looks like this. So yeah, it scales to a height of 250 in this case. And in the width, we have lots of white space left, which can be perfectly fine depending on what you want with it. How does that look the same direction for a smaller image? Well, we keep the same small image. The image is not touched at all. So the documentation fits. It does not scale up. So if your scale size already fits within the bounding box, then yeah, we won't do anything. Then we go to direction cover, also known as scale crop to fill or up. The documentation says this starts by scaling the largest dimension up to the required size, and it crops the other dimension if needed. Well, no, that's not true. It doesn't crop at all, at least not as far as I have seen. But I think I'm partially the one who wrote this documentation or improved a few things a couple of years ago. But yeah, let's try it out with the same width and height, but direction cover, same image. Yeah, it's the same end result. There's no difference, at least not for this image. It's the same as the previous one with the scale. Went in the wrong direction with my cursors. Try the smaller image. What happens here? Aha, there we do see a difference. We still have a lot of white space, but this image, it is scaled up. So that's the only difference that I saw for between direction scale and direction cover. There's no cropping done anywhere. But then we have the last direction, which is called contain, and that does do some cropping. It's also known as scale crop to fit or down. It starts by scaling the smallest dimension to the required size, and it crops the other dimension if needed. And yeah, we use the same width and height again, direction contain, same image. What is the end result? This. So here we use the entire width and entire height, and yeah, we lose some of the image, which is, yeah, that's what cropping is about. So depending on what you want in a design, this can look very nice. What happens with our smaller image? Yeah, basically the same. Yeah, it gets cropped up to become larger. And yeah, you lose the top part and the bottom part of the image. And now, yeah, if we see everything in one image, or well, 9 images here, I've added an extra image on the left, which is more in landscape mode. There you also see a bit of white space extra on the bottom. When you compare the top row with scale and the middle row with cover, the first two images are exactly the same, nothing changes. The only change is for the third column, the smaller image. Yeah, for cover it gets larger, as we saw. And the bottom row, yeah, everything is nicely, yeah, you use the entire width and height. So that's contain is the only part where any cropping happens at all. So for the cropping, we can ignore all the other scales and just use the contain. If we want to do cropping, you can look at Thumbboy. You can use that as an external service. And I've copied some of the documentation. It's a smart imaging service enabling on-demand crop, resizing, and flipping of images. It features a very smart detection of important points in the image for better cropping and resizing using state-of-the-art face and feature detection algorithms. More on that in the detection algorithms. In fact, for our customer, they have cakes and bread and very little faces, so I didn't do anything with face detection in my code. Using Thumbboy is easy. Once it's running, you just have to access a URL like this. In this case, localhost on port, and ignore the unsafe there, but it can be safe or unsafe. That's a detail. Give me 300 by 200 and make it smart. That means they do detection. And then a URL at the end to an encoded URL to an image. And then, yeah, you get the image back. And you could call this and load this implode. That would be one option to do it. In this case, I chose to copy some code from Thumbboy to some own customer code. Nice there is it uses an MIT license. So yeah, we can copy some code from there, as long as we say we copied it. So what do they use for detection? They use OpenCV, which is open source computer vision library. You can read a lot more about that on opencv.org. Thunberg uses some face detection from there, and feature detection. Feature detection is detect interesting parts of the image. That's basically the summary of that. And that's what we use to detect the nicest parts of the images with all the nice yummy cakes and bread. So how could we integrate this in Plone? I've created some customer code and copied it to my own GitHub account in experimental.focalpoints. You can follow the code along there a bit. The code examples that I give here in the presentation are a bit, I've made them a bit simpler, so they are a bit easier to follow without all the details. We create a tiny data class to capture some basic focal point information. We'll detect multiple features in the original image, so no faces. We'll summarize the focal points that are detected. We'll summarize them in one focal point. We'll get the center of mass of all those points that are detected. And then we need to use that single focal point as information when cropping a scale. And yeah, that's more the basic Python part. And then we need to hook that detection into Plone when we save an image, and the cropping when creating a scale. So how does that look? We've got a very simple focal point data class, which is, it uses an, you always want to say an add property, but it's a decorator. Data classes are new in Python 3.7, so you can't use it on 3.7 or earlier. And I could have used named tuples, which are somewhat the same. But yeah, this looked quite nice and easy. Just a simple class with an X coordinate and a Y coordinate and a weight. In this case, my code, the weight is always 1, actually. Then we have some feature detection. I've put that in a class, feature focal point detector, with a method that gets a pillow image. We convert it to L, and that's apparently the way to say make it grayscale. I'm not sure. I've taken that over from Thunberg. It might be a requirement for the OpenCV code that they want a grayscale, or it just goes a bit faster maybe that way. It also goes faster by creating a NumPy array. And without NumPy, it doesn't work. Actually, OpenCV really wants to have a NumPy array. And yeah, then we call good features to track, which is a function from OpenCV with just some parameters that I took over from Thunberg. And yeah, then you've got a list of points that are interesting in your image. If there are no points, we return. And otherwise, we get the X and Y coordinates and save that in our simple data class. And then, we return it as a list. So that's the detection in a few lines of code, actually. Then we should save it. We've got another class, original focal points transformer, which in this case takes a context, for example, a news item and a field or a field value, news item.image, that would be. And we call the feature focal point detector from the previous page. We call that on the field to gather all the focal points. If we don't see any focal points, then we clear any previously determined focal points that are stored on the field. And otherwise we have just a bit of simple mathematics and get center of mass to say, we've got some cloud of focal points that are interesting. Just take the central points of all those 20 points in this case. And it leads to one XY coordinate that we save on the field. So self.field in this case, that's a named blob image. We just add an extra attribute on there. And then we can use that information when we are cropping the image scale. Now I've made a class crop focal points transformer with a method called crop. You pass the image there and the width and height that you want, some other parameters. And yeah, you don't need to follow exactly what happens over there. And I've left out more than half of the code. But at least, yeah, you see we get self.fields.focalPoint with our nice XY coordinates. And the rest is basically, coming up with a rectangle of crop left, right, top and bottom, where our focal point is somewhere in the middle. And yeah, we use that near the bottom, pass that to pillImage.crop, and then we call pillImage.draft and resize. Yeah, those three methods together, yeah, that gives us a nicely cropped image with the given target width and target height. So this is all the crop that is needed. So then we need to say, okay, yeah, when do we actually calculate the focal points? We could do this when creating a scale, but then you say, okay, I want a preview scale here. Okay, let's look at the original, calculate all the focal points and create our scale. And now I want a mini scale. Okay, look at the original, calculate the focal points. Yeah, you're doing the work twice. Or you would need to store it on the first time you store it on the field, but then you need to say, yeah, maybe the field was changed, so we need to update it. So we won't do that one. Let's look at the second possibility. You can use a subscriber that also works. I've got some code for like that in the code. So I won't show it here. When an object is added or modified, you get all the image fields, and then yeah, you call a function to get the focal points and store it on every image. At least one problem with that is that it doesn't work for tiles. You would need to maybe get not only all the image fields but also all the tiles if they are there. And I haven't even thought about maybe portlets. And certainly not blocks for Volta, but that's a totally different subject. So yeah, maybe this doesn't get everything. You can override the named blob image dot set data, basically the setter for the named blob image. A problem there is the named blob image, that's the original is a named blob image, but all the scales that you create, those are also the same named blob image. It's the same class. So you take you save it on the blob image, then when creating a scale, you use the focal points. And then you would, when setting the data on for the scale, you would suddenly calculate the same focal points again. That's also doing things double, unless we would change this class to add some extra hints for that. But yeah, probably the best one is a setReceive form data manager. That's what I finally ended up with. This is called whenever you submit a form. So this is called when you add or edit a content item, and also when you edit a tile, and haven't checked it, but it should also be when you edit a portlet. And it's actually quite easy, just a few lines that you need to do. So I've got a utility function determine focal points for image. That's a small wrapper around the code that we saw just before. We import from setReceive form a data manager. We register have an adapter for our named blob image field. So every data manager for every field, it calls an adapter. In this case, we have one for named blob images. There's a setter, and at that point we determine the focal points for the image, and that method will actually set the focal point and the determined XY coordinates on the value. And then we just call the super method to set it on the field. You need to register it in ZCML. And if you use tiles, then you need to basically do something similar, but then for a dictionary field, because your context will not be a news item or image content type, but it's actually a dictionary for the tiles data. But it's very similar code also, basically one extra line somewhere. And then we want to create a scale and use this information. So to remind us, how do you create a scale? You call the images view, And then call the tag method of it with an image field name and some extra options. What happens then? Well, the images view that's defined in Plone named file scaling image scaling class, which has a tag method which calls a scale method. So we're hopping around a bit. This method calls Plone scale storage annotation score storage adapt for on the context, and which has another scale method. There are a lot of scale methods. This calls adapts an iImage scale factory for the context. This actually finds a default image scaling factory from Plone.named file. So we're back there again. This has a method create scale, which it calls, and that calls back to Plone scale.scale.scaleImage. Again, a lot of scales. And yeah, this finally calls scale build image method, which does the real actual work of cropping your image or scaling your image. So we're hopping around from Plone named file to Plone scale to Plone named file to Plone scale. So it's quite confusing actually. And yeah, then that could be improved. I've got some ideas for that. So meanwhile, somewhere in these six lines, we would have to override something for our cropping. The fourth line seems in the end the best line, the default image scaling factory. We will override that one. So we've got an override CCML in the code, adapter for a factory. We're calling it experimental image scaling factory. And you see that in the Python code below it. We just override from the default image scaling factory. Now, the first tiny thing that I want to change is to save the field name on this class, on this factory. And I need that somewhere further on in the create scale method. This is actually something I want to, a small fix I want to do in current Plone named file already. So go to the create scale method. This gets some image data, some direction and the height and width. Maybe a bit more, but I skipped that. I've got a small get scale mode utility function. I think that's from Plone scale, which handles the difference between mode and direction, which you could both do. And yeah, if mode is not contained, then we just call the original create scale methods, because we saw earlier contain is the only mode or direction which actually does any cropping. And then if our field does not have a focal point, then yeah, there's no sense in doing any cropping with our code. So we just call the original from Plone, which works fine. But if we do have focal points, then yeah, we open the image with pill. We get our crop focal points transformer that we saw earlier. And yeah, we run it on the image with our given width and height that we want. And we save it and return the result. And then yeah, the rest of the Plone named file or Plone scale code will make sure that it gets saved in the blob storage, actually. So well, there's some details were left out, but basically, yeah, a few extra lines of code and it works. When you actually want to use scales in tiles, yeah, you have some extra work to do. Need over Plone up tiles has its own image scaling module, which has its own version of the images view. And this actually uses some deprecated code from Plone named file, which should have been removed a long time ago already, but yeah, it's still in there. Luckily, it duplicates some code from either Plone named file or Plone scale or both. And in the duplication, it misses some of the bug fixes that have been done in Plone named file. So this could be improved, and I may want to do that on short term, even without the focal point cropping things. But yeah, there's something to be improved there. But yeah, then we can look at the end results. We've seen this part for our contain direction. This was what it looked like. And then with our automatic focal points detection, it becomes this, which is already better, especially the middle image is a lot better without all the vague top part of the image. And yeah, we saw this part, these images earlier, which make it even clearer. Yeah, very fuzzy first two images, and third image is okay-ish. And then afterwards, it looks like this, which is much nicer. I think we're 5 minutes left. Thank you, Kim. And yeah, that's the end result. So yeah, I can actually go to my summary, which is a bit earlier than during my testing, which is good. So yeah, here's the code. You can look at that, experimental.focalpoints. It's usable on Plone 5.2 and on 6.0. I've tried that on both. You do need Python 3.7 at the least. You need NumPy and OpenCV Python Headless. They are pulled in by the package. Those are big dependencies, so on some machines you might have trouble installing them, which could this might also mean it's difficult to put this in core Plone. Next to the fact that that the only direction or mode that does any cropping is the contain mode or scale crop to fit or down, and I don't think that's really used a lot in core Plone templates. You can use it in your own templates if that fits the design that you have. So yeah, as I said, in the near future, I want to port a few fixes from this package to plone.names file or plone.scale. That should make this package a bit easier, so I don't have to do as many overrides as we do now. And yeah, so that's I could stop here, but yeah, I do have a bit more that I could do. I also want to do a bit of a lightning talk with this evening, if that was accepted. I'll find out. I need to do a lot of overriding of several codes, mainly in named file and Plone scale, and yeah, they ping pong around a bit. So I wanted to check, can we do that differently? My idea should be an image transform chain. We already have a module package plone.transform chain, which even if you haven't looked at it, you are using it to transform HTML. For example, Plone app theming, I've used the Yatso that uses it, that's part of the transform chain. Plone protect does things there, Plone blocks, maybe not in this order. And yeah, we could use a similar idea for a Plone image transform chain to transform images. We could transform the original image using one transform chain, or the scaling part, we could do that in a transform chain. I think we might add this in Plone 6.1. I could create a blip for that if other people also think this is a good idea. So you could transform the original register, or this should be with all kinds of adapters or named adapters. There's probably no time to show code, but yeah, you could do things like, hey, someone uploads an image of 100 megabytes. Yeah, that's too much. On the fly, you downsize it to 10 megabytes and you store that as original. Or someone uploads a TIFF and yeah, you just create a JPEG of that. Plone scale actually does this during scaling. You can convert it to simpler mode, for example, grayscale, which Plone scale also does after scaling. And this is a part where we could do our focal point detection. We could do that here, combine it into one XY coordinate. Maybe this is a good space to delete old scales. And yeah, similar ideas for the transform scale. Apart from you do the transforms, we already have Plone scale, which is saving some EXIF information. We could do the cropping there. And so, yeah, we may have more time to show a bit of this during the lightning talk. I should probably round up and not show this code or this code. And instead just say thank you. And there's another before and after image, about 1 year between them. So hello from me and from Tobias. And I'll see you in the Jitsi room.
Thank you, Maurits. That was fascinating. And I love the kid picture. All right. Well, thank you, Maurits, for this great talk, focal points, and this smart cropping. That's a brilliant addition. That would be wonderful to have in Plone. So So thank you for doing all that. And I guess we should probably thank your client too for asking you to do it. So please.